Good afternoon, everyone. Today, as this terrible virus touches every part of our society, I want to express my deepest sympathies to the families of those three Northern Ireland people who have sadly lost their lives, bringing the total number of deaths here in Northern Ireland to 73. It is imperative that we come together for these daily press conferences, that we never lose sight that in towns and rural communities and in homes across Northern Ireland, there are families mourning. These are difficult times, and sadly, there will be more dark days and weeks ahead. I also want to send my support and very best wishes to our Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, as he fights COVID-19. I know how hard he has been working alongside his Cabinet colleagues to prepare the entire country for the surge in cases of coronavirus. I have no doubt that he's receiving the very best of care from dedicated and skilled doctors and nurses at St Thomas's Hospital in London. My thoughts and prayers are with him for a speedy recovery and with his partner and family. A partner and family who share the fear and anxiety felt by so many families here in Northern Ireland and across these islands. This morning I had the opportunity to visit our new Nightingale Hospital, which has been established at the City Hospital in Belfast. In only a week, the transformation of the city tower block has been truly remarkable. Similarly, this afternoon I visited the Regional Virology Lab over at the Royal. I had the privilege of meeting some of the staff working at both locations, and again I want to take this opportunity to thank them for everything they are doing, the immense contribution they are making and will continue to make in the coming weeks. PPE and indeed ventilators are, as always, top of our agenda, and I want to take this opportunity to provide an update. As I said last week, there's not a country in the world that knows with any certainty what path this virus is going to take. But am I confident that our staff have access to the right PPE and get it when they need it? Yes, I am, because I appreciate that some staff are understandably concerned about what lies ahead. So I want to reassure them as Health Minister. I will not allow or tolerate our health workers being put in danger as a result of inadequate PPE. The well-being of our staff and patients is my utmost priority right now. We do have sufficient PPE supply for the current demand, and I and my staff, working along with the Department of Finance, are working hard to secure more supplies for any future demand or second surge later in the year. Yesterday, I was delighted to see a packed warehouse with the first of the 5.5 million items of PPE, and there'll be more to follow. We must never become complacent. However, so I would much more prefer to come out the other side of this pandemic with far too much PPE remaining in stock than not enough. Earlier today, I was also pleased to be able to confirm that we had now increased the total of mechanical ventilators used in critical care to 197. Further substantial orders are in place for additional ventilators and a wide range of devices capable of providing respiratory support. I want to reassure all those listening right now across the health and social care in Northern Ireland that as things currently stand, there is sufficient capacity, equipment and oxygen to provide critical care for those who need it. But because the worst of this virus is yet to come, we must remain vigilant. That is why we have additional ventilators in order to meet our estimated clinical care need. And sadly, the number of admissions are increasing. Yesterday alone, there were a further 96 COVID-related hospital admissions. And by today, there are now 55 COVID-related patients across Northern Ireland in critical care. That is why it's so essential that we also have the staff to provide care for all those who need it. I am very pleased to report that our successful drive to build up our workforce continues to produce results. I never doubted that the people of Northern Ireland would rise to the many challenges that we are facing. The workforce appeal has led to 15,895 expressions of interest, and to date, they have been converted into 9,037 formal applications. 230 applicants are already either appointed or pending appointment, and many others will follow. All across Northern Ireland, individuals, families and communities are rising to the immense challenge created by social distancing. I want to thank them publicly and to acknowledge the sacrifices that they are making. It is essential, however, that the current restrictions are rigorously maintained. Quite simply, people's lives depend on the actions that we take now. Don't let them down. Don't let the health service down, and keep fighting back. Just because the sun is out doesn't mean you have to be out of your homes. No one is safe from COVID-19. And as we approach the Easter period, I would urge everyone to continue playing their part in helping to halt the spread of this virus. Stay indoors as much as possible. Do not travel to beauty spots or for a walk, no matter what the weather is like. Together, we can push back against COVID-19 and the surge. Together, we can beat this. I will now pass to Dr. Michael McBride, the Chief Medical Officer, who will speak about the Memorandum of Understanding and the clinical trials.
Thank you, Minister. I just want to take this opportunity to add my sincere condolences to all of those families who have sadly lost one loved ones to date. I also want to express my condolences to the three further deaths that we have heard of today. I think it's important that we all bear in mind behind those numbers are people. There are people with families and there are people with friends. There are many of us right across Northern Ireland that are being directly or indirectly affected by COVID-19 at this time. This virus makes no distinction. It knows no boundaries. And I just want to put on record my hope and prayers that those who are currently affected by COVID-19 make a full and speedy recovery. I know that all of those that we've heard of from the Minister who are in hospital are in the very best of hands, and they are getting the expert health and social care that can be provided by dedicated and committed frontline staff. This virus knows no boundaries, as I've said. It doesn't discriminate, and it is quite possible that in the weeks and months ahead that every one of us will know someone, if not ourselves, who have been affected by the virus. And that's why I'm encouraging the people of Northern Ireland, all patients who are affected with COVID-19, to play their part in the NHS-wide clinical trials for COVID-19. Those trials will be conducted in primary care, they will be conducted in patients who are in hospital, and also those individuals who require support in our intensive care units. It is vitally important that we recruit individuals as quickly as possible into those randomized controlled trials so that individuals can benefit from the treatment, but also so that we generate the evidence here in Northern Ireland, right across the United Kingdom, the Republic of Ireland, and internationally about those drugs that are going to be of benefit. I want to thank those individuals who are contributing to those studies at this time. I want to acknowledge the clinicians and researchers who are working dedicatedly to identify those drugs that provide the best candidates for those clinical trials. As I say, the quicker we recruit to those trials, the sooner the studies get done, the more evidence we will generate and the more people will benefit. Today, as the Minister has said, we have formally signed off on a memorandum of understanding between the Department of Health, Northern Ireland, and the Republic of Ireland. Now, that memorandum of understanding underpins and strengthens cooperation on the public health response to COVID-19. Cooperation has been well established for many years, and the memorandum reaffirms our commitment to work together for the benefit of all citizens. We have to keep working together nationally and internationally, and also locally. Let me just conclude by echoing the Minister's appeal to everyone to keep doing what we are currently doing. The social distancing in place must be strictly maintained in the days and weeks ahead. Now, I know those restrictions are tough. I know how difficult they are. I just want to also add my thanks to the words of the Minister in thanking the public who have been adhering to those social distancing measures. They're unlike anything that we have faced before, but we just have to stick with them. I can indicate to you today that there are emerging signs that these measures are making a difference in Northern Ireland, and your actions are and will continue to save lives. Now, I say this tentatively at this point. We will update and share our reasonable worst-case scenario modelling publicly when that is finalised. But complacency at this time remains our greatest challenge. If we relax those measures, we will see again further increases in admissions of patients with COVID-19, further people getting sick and requiring admission to our intensive care units, and potentially overwhelm our health service. We need to stick with those measures. They will save lives and will make the difference between someone having access to the care that they need and someone not having access to the care that they need. So now is not the time to relax our guard or congratulate ourselves. Not the time for us to feel fatigued and think, do we really need to keep doing this? We have to dig in for the weeks and months ahead because, as we've said before, lives literally depend upon it. So please, everyone, keep doing what you're doing. Keep following the advice on social distancing. Stay at home unless you have to go out and the limited circumstances that we have outlined. Keep washing your hands. Let's keep each other safe. Let's keep everyone else safe, and let's protect our health service. Thank you.
It's Ken Reid of UTV here. Could I go back to the testing topic? What are the plans now to open other testing centres in the days ahead? One question being asked, when people are tested, I appreciate it will be health workers initially, how long will it be before the test results are known? And just how reliable are these tests? And then I think we'll all be pleased to hear the comments of the Chief Medical Officer that perhaps social distancing is having an effect. But could I say that there's been 73 terrible deaths that you have mentioned? Is that the real figure? And is it possible that others in the community outside hospitals are also dying from this terrible virus?
If I could deal with the last of those questions first, Ken, thank you for the question. What we're reporting at the minute are hospital deaths. There will always be a lag time in terms of the official reporting of deaths, official statistics through the registration of deaths. And it is possible that there are other deaths in the community which, when we see those official statistics come through, may be attributed to COVID-19. I would say that we're taking an ultra inclusive approach to reporting deaths from COVID-19. Details, but we're reporting anyone who has tested positive for COVID-19, who dies in hospital within who dies having tested positive for COVID-19 in the last 28 days. We need to recognize that there are many people who will die with COVID-19 and with the positive test, but not necessarily directly as a consequence of COVID-19. I think that it'll be probably many months before we're able to tell the full picture in terms of those people who have died directly as a cause of COVID-19. Those who have died with COVID-19, but not necessarily as the main cause of death, and then a further period of time before we're able to ascertain what the excess mortality is. So each year we look, for instance, in seasonal flu, we will estimate the number of deaths that we might expect to see in the community, and then we will look for the excess mortality. It will be many weeks and months before we're able to answer fully the question around excess deaths. In terms of testing, we have and face significant limitations in relation to the availability of reagents, which we've highlighted before. Those are in global demand. We have put together a consortium with the University of Ulster, Queen's University, Seatrick, our pathology laboratories here in Northern Ireland, the Forensic Science Laboratory, using a range of platforms and different reagents so that we can ramp up our testing. Obviously, at this point in time, in the delay phase, having moved from the containment phase, our priority has to be, as I'm sure everyone will understand, the clinical care of those who are hospitalised and sick, whether that's individuals admitted to hospital or those who are in our intensive care units, and then primarily health and care workers so we can ensure we can get those back into the front line. There has been a commitment separately to that as we ramp up that capacity here in the health service in Northern Ireland that on a UK-wide basis, there's a partnership with a range of commercial partners, and you've seen that testing get started and underway last weekend in the SSE Arena car park. That will be rapidly ramping up, and that increasingly will be the mechanism by which we will be using to test healthcare workers. And obviously, the priority has to turn around the samples for clinical patients first, because it's crucial to determine their optimal treatment and care. Then our healthcare workers, the turnaround time for the tests that are available through the UK partnership at this present moment is around 3 days. Fully anticipate that the numbers tested will ramp up and the turnaround times will improve as well.
And Ken, just to back up what the Chief Medical Officer is saying, we're taking that dual approach to testing in Northern Ireland. We're part of the greater UK scheme, which is the SSE Arena, but we're also concentrating on increasing our own in-house capacity, which is the use of our universities, our own labs, AFBI, even the forensic science labs here in Northern Ireland. So it's about capturing and making use that we make use of the best capacity that we have in-house as well.
Hi, David Young from PA Media here. You'll be aware, yesterday in the South, in the Irish Republic, Chief Medical Officer was expressing a degree of optimism that they had potentially pushed out the peak and flattened it somewhat. And the evidence base they were using for that was the fact that, yes, there are deaths being reported every day, but to date, the totals have been quite sort of similar every day. There hasn't been a dramatic rise in deaths. And it seems to be our experience in Northern Ireland seems to be similar at that point. Does that give you cause for similar optimism here in terms of the curve and whether we are flattening it and pushing it back? And just a secondary question in regard to the restrictions that might be linked to that progress. Matt Hancock warned at the weekend that some people weren't abiding by certain restrictions still across the water. Is there any evidence of that here? And if so, is there a potential for further restrictions to prevent that?
Well, David, I'll take your second question first, and I suppose it's in regards to social distancing and the appeal that has come from both myself and the Chief Medical Officer here at this press conference, but also from the First and Deputy First Minister when they addressed the ad hoc committee in the Assembly Chamber earlier today. The importance of social distancing, we cannot stress enough. Mm-hmm. We're only at the start of the potential peak that we've been looking at from our worst-case scenario. These measures do seem to be working, but they have to be maintained. And that's why the Chief Medical Officer's comments about complacency. Complacency can be our biggest enemy at this minute in time, because if people don't see the direct effect it's having today, they may think that their actions aren't playing a part. They do. Because your actions today will affect where our health service is in 2 weeks' time, where those numbers are in a fortnight's time. And that's why it's crucial that we maintain the measures that are in place. And I think you'll also see, coming forward this weekend, especially as we come into the Easter holidays, you will see an increased pressure or an increased presence of the police service in Northern Ireland on our roads, actually making sure that anybody who has taken a journey outside the home is doing so because of essential purposes. It's important that we use the resources wisely at this minute in time. So that's why we're asking people to stay at home. There shouldn't be a need for us putting the police on the roads to make sure your journey is essential. People should be responsible enough to have that in their own head, that what their actions today will have a dramatic effect.
Yeah, again, just on that, David, I mean, I said a number of weeks ago, none of us should look back and say, I wish I'd done more. I wish I'd followed the advice when it was given to me. And as I said then, and the minister has said, it's going to make the difference between someone having access to the excellent care that our health service in Northern Ireland provides, access to a ventilator when they need it or not. There is no doubt that the measures that we put in place are beginning to have an impact. Complacency is our greatest enemy at this time. We are looking through a very long rear view mirror at the moment. So sadly, it takes people many a week of illness, a week of deterioration, and then maybe a week of very supportive care in our hospitals before sadly they and tragically they die. Sometimes it's more rapid than that. So looking at death is a very late marker of the benefits that we're seeing in terms of the lives saved as a consequence of the social distancing measures. Again, what we will be looking for and are looking at very closely are the number of new cases, looking at the number of those new cases that translate in then into hospital admission, and the number of those hospital admissions that translate then into admissions into intensive care. There are some encouraging signs, there are early signs that again we're experiencing reduced levels of transmission. The key thing that we're trying to achieve, as we mentioned before, and I'm sure you know your viewers will now be familiar with, is to reduce the reproductive number. So at the early days of the pandemic and how the virus was spreading across these islands, it was sitting at around 2.5, 2.8. There are suggestions that now we may have pushed that below one. So that means instead of 2.5 or 2.8 people being infected for every one new person infected, it may be one person infected or less. If that's the case, that is good news. It also means that the doubling times, so that's the number of new infections that we see, which was previously 3 to 4 days, gets pushed out to more than that. We have some emerging trends that's the case, but that's been hard achieved. You know, that has been achieved by the public in Northern Ireland following the advice and doing the right thing. This virus hasn't gone away. It's not going away anytime soon. If we were to relax those measures at this time, that this virus would come back and we would end up being overwhelmed, and our health service and our healthcare professionals have been overwhelmed with the impact that it would have. So the minister's words about just because the sun's out doesn't mean to say you should be out, just to reinforce that what the public in Northern Ireland are doing at this time is making an impact. It is crucially important, because lives depend on it, that we all stick to that advice and follow that advice.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Jane McCormack, BBC here. You've talked about people sticking to the measures, but are you concerned that the longer that this goes on for, there will be a slipping back as people inevitably get fed up following the rules? So what I'm asking is it too soon to start talking about some kind of an exit strategy for people to at least know what the way out of this is going to be? And secondly, in terms of information that you're giving out, can you tell us how many health workers have been tested so far across Northern Ireland? And also, is there going to be more information coming forward around clusters potentially in care homes, for example, because we don't seem to have that information yet?
Okay. Jane, in regards to the messaging, I don't want to put out a message here today that we're thinking about relaxing some of the measures when we're actually seeing a situation where we may actually have to make them stronger, because we can only relax measures if people actually adhere to and follow the guidance that we're putting here. So when the indication comes, you know, we're over a week, we're two, no, this isn't going to go away at the end of the restrictions. So when we look at the restrictions in 2 or 3 weeks' time, it may be we're extending that period, we may actually be putting in more restrictions. So to send out the message here today that, you know, in 3 weeks' time, this will all be fine, COVID-19 has left Northern Ireland, that message is wrong. What we have to get into people's heads and minds is COVID-19 and the coronavirus is in Northern Ireland, and it's here and it's across the world for a very long time. So these measures may have to be ramped up and they may have to be scaled back. and at different points as we see how this virus progresses across Northern Ireland. In regards to your specific ask and the number of care homes, the information that I have coming out here today, we have 20 care homes across Northern Ireland where we have COVID-19 positive results, but they are being managed along with the RQIA and with the PHA. And if anybody needs to be moved from a care home to a hospital or into ICU, that's been done. There's no time lag, there's no delay been done as that, because a resident of a care home is a member of our society, so they won't be treated any different, nor should they be. In regards to the additional information you're talking about, we have committed towards the end of this week on a modelling scenario and a dashboard that we've established within the department that there will be more detailed information become available.
Just, Minister, I think your point around fatigue is really important because, you know, we all know how difficult these measures are and how hard it feels to stick with them. But it is beginning to make a difference. I really don't like the term exit strategy because we need to remind ourselves what we're dealing with here. We're dealing with a virus which none of us have had immunity to unless we've been exposed to it and infected by it. A virus which at this point in time we don't have any effective treatment for, and hence the importance of the clinical trials, and a virus for which we don't have a vaccine. So therefore, to talk about an exit strategy, I'd be happy to talk about an exit strategy when we have effective treatments and when we have a vaccine. We're not in that place at this point in time. But we also need to recognise that the price that we're paying now in relation to the social distancing measures is a high one. The things that we can't do, that families can't do, the impact that that's having on our mental health and well-being is not insignificant or inconsequential. The impact that it's having on our health service in terms of those individuals who otherwise would be accessing treatment and care, despite the fact we're putting alternatives in place to support those individuals and continue that care where that's absolutely essential. But in the longer term, in the medium to longer term, the impact that socioeconomic impact that this is having, and we know that is profound in terms of exacerbating the inequalities in health that we see. We know that poverty in the longer term kills people too. We know that employment is good for your health. So these are all things that are finely balanced, and these are things that ministers here and right across the United Kingdom and across these islands will be considering. We are far, far too early to even begin contemplating, as the minister said, at stepping back or stepping away from these measures at this point in time, because this virus is out there and will just come straight back at us. But what we do need to begin to think about as time moves on as to whether or not there are some elements of our current approach as we get through this surge that we need to look at again, and that those decisions will need to be advised by the best scientific evidence that we have, the best modelling that we have, recognising, you know, that we are in uncharted territory here. We have not in living memory applied these measures in modern times. We have not had to deal with a virus that of this magnitude and this import. The direct impact that it's having, as the Minister alluded to, in terms of the lives lost to date, the impact indirectly it's having on all of us, and the longer term impacts that it may have on all of us as well. And we need to manage all of those things.
Hello there, Adam Kula, the newsletter here. We had a release from the executive earlier on saying that the first peak period is estimated to be between the 6th and the 20th of this month. What do your models predict? When do your models predict the second wave may fall? I'm by no means asking for exact dates, but roughly is it end of summer or Christmas time? And you'd mentioned earlier there are 55 people with COVID-19 in critical care beds at the moment. What's our number of critical care beds across the province currently, please, in total?
Do you want to pick up on the pick?
Yeah, just, I mean, we're planning, as you've heard from our plan that we announced last week, reasonable worst case scenario, we're planning for having upwards of 180 people requiring intensive care at any one time. We have planned to have well in excess of that. So the Minister said in his opening statement, we are confident at this moment in time that we will have both the personal protective equipment and all of the ventilator capacity that we need to ensure that we are able to meet the needs of individual patients and to provide all the healthcare support that in terms of those providing that care with PPE that's required. We also have significant numbers of additional ventilators on order, which will bring us up to an additional 400 and a range of other respiratory units, which are not ventilators, but again, you'll have heard about masks, CPAP, which administers pressurized oxygen into the lungs to keep the lungs open, which actually makes it easier for people to breathe. And again, emerging evidence that if we support people's breathing at an earlier point in time with interventions such as CPAP, we can reduce the requirement for individuals to progress onto requiring ventilation. The Minister alluded to the new Nightingale facility. We're working and have worked with all of our trusts across Northern Ireland to flex up the critical care bed capacity across all our existing trusts. And then as the need arises, to ensure that we increase the capacity in the new Nightingale Hospital ICU capacity on the city site. So I'm confident that we will have the ICU capacity that we require and the ventilators that we require to meet the current projected needs. Now, in terms of my comments earlier, we keep the modelling constantly under review because, as Minister has said and as I've said, the modelling is just that. Those are models. They are not predictions or forecasts, and they are fundamentally dependent on what you do, what I do, and what we all do. So if we all continue to observe the advice around social distancing, then the numbers of people who acquire COVID-19, the number of people who get hospitalised, the number of people who end up in intensive care and requiring intensive care support will diminish. So the final numbers depend on all of us and what we're doing or not doing. In terms of your other question, just remind me.
Modelling,
yeah. The modelling we keep under constant review. We should be in a position, looking at the impact of social distancing, to share some further information on modelling, I would have thought, either towards the end of this week or early next week. But again, that is something which we continually keep under review, and then we modify the capacity in our critical care facilities accordingly.
Adam, you maybe missed my opening statement where I said we actually had now at this minute in time 197 mechanical ventilators in Northern Ireland. So that's where we are at the minute. As the Chief Medical Officer referred to our new Nightingale facility, I was there this morning and had a walk through the wards as they were getting ready to set that up. I met with the staff, I met with the nurses, I met with the doctors, I met with the consultants who will actually be manning and staffing that facility in the days and weeks that lie ahead. So as the Chief Medical Officer said, people's actions today will depend on how much pressure those individuals actually come under. But there's one of the things, I met a group of actually ward sisters as they were getting a briefing before they took up their duties on the wards. And one of the things one of them asked me to say to the general public, and that was actually a message from her to say, thank you very much for the support you are currently showing us. Thank you very much for the pizzas you're sending in. Thank you very much for the support that we're getting out on the street. But one thing that is critical, how we think our health and social care workers at this minute in time is by following the advice of staying at home and cutting down the amount of a potential spread that this virus can have at this minute in time. If anybody out there wants to truly thank a member of our health and social care staff or a frontline worker, please follow the advice that we're giving you for the next 2 to 3 weeks, because your actions today will have an impact on their workload in the next couple of weeks. Mm.